Hi, I'm Chris Heiser from Internet 2 in University of Pennsylvania, and I'm going to talk about grouper training, admin track, web services part 2. I'll give an introduction, talk about configuring the web services, how to log requests, making your web services more highly available, monitoring that the servers are up and healthy, and helping developers troubleshoot. So web services uses the grouper API, and it interfaces with applications via the grouper client or various connectors or custom web service clients that write to the grouper web service API. To configure the grouper web services, the settings are in the grouper-ws.properties. You can look in that file for all the options, and here are some examples. You can control who has access to the web services by group by setting ws.client.user.group.name to some group name. If you configure this, you could also auto-create that group and auto-assign users in the grouper.properties to help bootstrap the system and make sure everything is configured for new environments. You can also configure which users can act as other users. So ws.act.as.group, and you can say either people in that group can act as anybody, or you could specify which group they're allowed to act as so that they can't act as administrators. You would do this for applications where the users are using the application and they need to see access from grouper that they would see if they logged in. So the service credential that the application is using is authenticating to the grouper web services, but it's telling the web services to act as the user who logged into the application. You could also configure which subject attributes are sent back to the client by default. So there are two levels. There's the regular send these attributes back on every request, or if the client identifies that they want detailed attributes, you could set a list of attributes to be sent back for those requests. Also, the client can request attributes by name, so if there are attributes that aren't in these lists and the clients need them, they could identify that in the request. Logging for all grouper services is controlled via the log4j.properties. If you're in a test environment and you have a non-SSL way for clients to connect to the web services, clients can easily proxy that and capture the request and response. If it is SSL, then the client is going to have to accept the certificate that the proxy server proxies, even though it won't match the domain. So errors for web services are generally returned to the client, and they can diagnose those themselves. The grouper client has the --debug=true switch to log requests and responses. So if you have a operation with the grouper client, java-jar grouper client.jar --operation=get members ws --group names=a group name, anything that you want to run with the grouper client, if you put --debug=true, it will run, and then it will capture the request that's being sent to the server, and it'll indent that. So in this case, this is the request that was sent, and including the HTTP headers, and then it will capture the response from the server, including HTTP headers. Although some of them, like the J session ID and the authentication, will be stripped so that it's not a security problem. And then their response will be indented and formatted so that you can easily read it. This is only useful for XML web services, though the object model is the same for JSON and XHTML and SOAP. So you could easily translate to other formats from these examples. You can log requests and responses on the server in grouper 2.1.1 and newer. Generally, you should not do this in production. You edit the web XML by uncommenting the filter mapping, which adds the logging filter to either the rest or soap servlet or both. And you add the log4j debug setting for the servlet filter logger class, and then the logs will end up in your log4j logs.
You'll want to probably deploy your grouper web services so that they will be highly available. You could have multiple app servers connected to one registry, and you might want to have session persistence based on source IP address of the clients, so that if you're spread across multiple web service servers and there's caching, you'll have repeatable reads. There are many ways to do this. Here are two ways. The first one is the client connects to the load balancers, who will pick a server based on some load balancing algorithm, and that server will connect to the registry. This architecture has no single point of failure except for the registry and perhaps the data center and other networking components like switches or firewalls. For improved availability, you can deploy in multiple data centers. You can load balance on the client. So in this case, we have a data center that has that same architecture and that has replication one way or two way to another data center, and the client is going to decide if there's an error, a timeout, to send the request to a different data center. The grouper client has this logic built in, or a custom client could develop this logic. You would monitor the grouper web services just like any other web application. There's a status servlet that can check the health. You would hook up that status servlet to monitoring software, for example, Nagios. So that monitoring software would email you when a server is down. So if you go to your web service URL, and there are many diagnostic types. If you don't put a diagnostic type, it'll tell you that you need to pass one in. And then you can put in a diagnostic type, for instance, database. And this is going to go and check all the databases that are configured in Grouper. You could also check sources, which will go and try to do a search for a subject in each of the sources. And then you can do all, which will also check to make sure that loader jobs have run within a certain amount of time. So you can find out if any sources are unavailable, loader jobs, etc., with this status servlet that would be hooked up to Nagios.
So the status servlet in Grouper WS will return a 200 HTTP status code on success and probably a 500 on failure. But generally you look for the 200 to mean success, and anything else will be failure. You can have log4j errors emailed to the admins if you want in production, so that you know when errors are occurring. Here's an example of a log4j block to set up mail of errors to be sent to the support staff.
Troubleshooting, generally clients will receive a descriptive error to troubleshoot their own problems. You can refer clients to the web services samples and documentation. The grouper client with that dash dash debug can show examples of requests and responses, and you can also contact the grouper user's email list. Please click on the quiz link in the video description to reinforce your knowledge of this topic. Thank you very much.